Movie Crusaders, and welcome to my latest episode. My name's Sean Wasserkrug, and today we're reviewing one of the more anticipated horror films of the year, Jordan Peele's Nope. Now, for me, I've been a huge fan of Jordan Peele ever since, obviously, the Key and Peele days. I loved that comedy show so much, and I wish they would still do that from time to time. But Jordan Peele has gone behind the camera now for his third film, which... You know, Jordan Peele's installments of Get Out, which, you know, was a Best Picture nominee, and Us, which I actually really quite enjoyed, have really caused a big anticipation for pretty much all of his films now that, too, he's already into his third film, has already reached the echelon of not people saying, hey, let's go see Nope, but, hey, let's go see the new Jordan Peele film. And honestly, for only being his third film directed overall, that's a pretty big thing to be basically, let's go see the new Jordan Peele film instead of let's go see this horror film Nope. But with Nope, this is one of those movies that I kind of tried my best to go in with the least amount of knowledge, and so that way I keep my expectations relatively low. Now, granted, we do know that this has an element with aliens and UFOs because, you know, trailers are all over the place and it's very hard to hide it. Plus, it didn't really hide it in the first trailer from the get-go. But things that really made me kind of excited to see this film overall is we got Daniel Kaluuya back, which, you know, like I said, he was nominated for Best Actor for Get Out. Kiki Palmer is an actress that I really enjoy watching. And also Steven Yeun from The Walking Dead, who doesn't love Steven Yeun from The Walking Dead? So having these three actors in this film was definitely enough to get me to want to see this on top of the fact that it's Jordan Peele's third directed film. Now, a lot of people put Get Out on this incredibly high pedestal. I think Get Out's a really good film. I do think that it's a little overrated, but I still think it's a good film nonetheless. And Us, I prefer Us over Get Out, but I do understand and realize that Us has a lot of story issues and a lot of things that don't quite add up that needed a little more explanation, a little more understanding, but I think the execution of what was in the film worked immensely. So with Nope, you're going to get kind of a lot more of Us, but I don't think it works necessarily to the same effect that I think Us did, especially for me. But like I said, this is my review. You guys might have watched it and loved it. To me, I'm kind of in the middle. I've gone back and forth between, liking the film to being generally disappointed with the film overall. But let's go ahead and just go with what actually is good and what actually works with Nope overall first. First things first, the cinematography of this film is fantastic. It looks gorgeous. Pretty much almost every shot in the film, and I normally don't look up the cinematographers and stuff like that, but this movie does look gorgeous, so I do want to give a call out to the cinematographer, which is, of course, it's got to be a name that's hard to say, Hoyt van Hoytema. I probably said that wrong. I apologize. It looks gorgeous. Now, granted, most films that are usually like out in the West or in, like, you know, a very deserty kind of hills and valleys kind of place, most times than not, they will look pretty amazing. Look at Power of the Dog last year. It was a gorgeous cinematography film. And this movie is pretty much the same. When we do actually get to see the said UFOs in the film, they look great. Everything about this movie looks fantastic. There was never really, outside of maybe one thing in the film, which I'm not really going to dive too much into because of spoilers, I think for the most part, everything in this film looks great, and there's very, very little eye rolling in terms of, oh, wow, that looked bad. Very minimal, if at all. Another thing that works really, really well in Nope is the sound design. The sound design is amazing. If you have the ability to see this in IMAX, that's definitely the way to watch it. Or if you're at home, if you have a surround sound system. The sound system in this, or the sound design in this movie is fantastic, whether it be the powering down of energy when the UFOs are near to the sounds that they make off in the distance to many, many other things that I won't delve into, but when you watch the movie, you will 100% know what I'm talking about. Cinematography-wise and sound design could be the thing that gets Nope into the Oscar race at the end of the year, especially more for sound design. Now, cinematography it might get pushed out because it came out in July compared to the movies that come out later in the year. But I think sound design-wise, we could be seeing Nope as a nominated film. In terms of the performances, I really liked pretty much almost all the performances in this film. Daniel Kaluuya is an actor that I really enjoy watching more times than not. I will say the first act of this film, I was a little frustrated with his performance because he does kind of play it off like a... I don't want to say he plays it off lazy because that's totally not the character that he's playing in this, but he's very just kind of mumbles and acts like he doesn't want to do... like he's doing his job, he doesn't look like he's happy about doing his job, and he just kind of looks annoyed, and like I said, he kind of just through the first act of the film. But once we get into the second act and to the inevitable third act, Daniel Kaluuya's performance of OJ definitely elevates and really starts to see the great acting chops that Daniel Kaluuya has had for many years so far. And I really enjoyed his character as the movie progressed, not so much in the beginning. Same thing also will go with Kiki Palmer as Emerald Haywood, OJ's sister. Now, granted, most of the scenes that we see from her in the trailers are in that first act. And in the first act, she is incredibly annoying. She is brash. She's loud. She just doesn't know when to be quiet at certain points. There are certain moments where she really just needs to listen and not try to just constantly overtalk and stuff like that. And she's a very annoying character. But once we start getting into the meat of the film and the main plot of the story, her character does, I don't want to say get quiet or tempered down, but she really kind of finds the sweet spot of M in the film. And you really do enjoy her performance overall. And even while I didn't enjoy the first part of her performance, she played it greatly because that was what she's supposed to do. She's supposed to be annoying. She's supposed to be loud and brash and kind of obnoxious through the film. And Kiki does a great job with it. So while I didn't enjoy the character, she performed it really, really well. You know, well enough to the point that she's one of the better female performances I've seen of the year so far. Two people that I was not expecting to like, and not that I didn't think that they were going to be good performances, but I just really, really enjoyed them throughout the film to the point where I wanted more of them. One is Brandon Perea, who plays Angel. He's kind of the third person of this group that he basically is like the... He works for Fry's, but he's like the Best Buy Geek Squad guy, and who kind of basically gets brought in to help out OJ and M in a certain like situation in the film, and eventually basically just joins the group. I really enjoyed his performance overall. I really enjoyed his character. He was a lot of fun. He's basically more of the us in the film, and I really enjoyed his performance enough to the point that it will make me take notice of him in future roles down the road. And then another actor who we haven't seen in quite a while, or at least I haven't seen in quite a while, is Michael Wincott. I know him best from Three Musketeers and, you know, Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, where he always plays a bad guy. But he plays Antlers Hoyt, or Holst, who's basically a cinematographer. And in the scenes we do get of him, I really, really liked Wincott in this film. And I really enjoyed him. He's got that really gravelly voice for anyone who's ever seen him, you know, perform. But it's just his performance, I was just drawn to it. Whenever he was on screen, he was just that character that you just kind of wanted to focus on and pay attention to and listen to every word he has to say. And I really enjoyed his performance overall. Steven Yeun, he's probably the one character to me that is the most frustrating. And it's not because his performance isn't good. I think Steven Yeun as Ricky Jupe Park, I think he actually does a really good job in the film. It's his subplot and his story that really is kind of more of the head-scratcher of the film. This subplot about his character, or at least his past, is constantly forced into the narrative of the film, but ultimately really doesn't hold any weight in the movie. And you could argue that, oh, because of this thing, it allowed his character to be more open to this. Yes, I can see that connection, but did it need to be overly used in the film? Did we constantly keep having to go back to these moments in his past to elevate this character that, frankly, even though while I love Steven Yeun's performance, his character is really not that important to the overall landscape of this film. His character is important to a point in the film, and then that's basically it. So to focus that much backstory on this particular character really just felt unnecessary and ultimately was a failed attempt for Jordan Peele in the movie overall. In terms of the other performances, everyone else is relatively solid, but no one else is... It's basically these five that are the real main people that you got to pay attention to in the film overall. So like I said, cinematography is great, sound design is great, the performances are all really great. It is ultimately, for me, the story and how Jordan Peele kind of did the story that really just kind of didn't really hit for me. It's got just as many plot holes and loose ends as Us did, to the point where it kind of got frustrating at times. The OJ character got increasingly smarter, which I'm not saying that he was dumb, because he's a clever character, but just he's understanding things and he's figuring things out that really there's no basis of it to figure certain those situations out, and then to have that actually be what the situation was. There was no real outlier to show, hey, this is why this is happening, so obviously this is what this is, and here's the plan. I know I'm speaking very vague, but I'm trying not to spoil this movie. And like I said, and the ultimate final goal of these characters in the movie, it's by the end of the film, it's just really not that important. And it's one of those things where, yes, that's maybe the outlier that they're striving for, but this their ultimate storyline point is something that's underneath, which I totally get that. I get what you guys are going to say if you guys are going to come at me and attack me for this. But I think, ultimately, there's a lot of good ideas in this film, and it visually and sound-wise, it all looks great. But ultimately, it just doesn't all mesh perfectly well. I still liked the movie. I thought it was an enjoyable one-time watch. It's not something I would ever probably go back and rewatch again. And for me, out of Jordan Peele's three films, this is definitely my least favorite of his. But even my least favorite Jordan Peele film is still going to be better than most films out there. But ultimately, like I said, I just felt like this movie... Not that it was missing something. It's just that I feel like Jordan Peele really kind of went at this in a way that really kind of felt disjointed at times. He does this thing with, like... chapters almost to a point, which the chapters really don't matter. They really aren't important to the film, and they focus on these certain elements without me actually giving them away, that it's just like, okay, I get that, but is it really that important to the script, to the film, that we are focusing on these little points, or can we just go through the movie and kind of get to this one element? And the UFO side of things, it works, but it doesn't. I will say this is very much a Close Encounters of the Third Kind meets Jaws. And I will say this, you will definitely look at clouds a different way now. So in terms of trying to be like a Jaws tagline where just when you thought it was safe to go back in the water, this movie is definitely just when you thought it was okay to look up at the clouds, which this movie shouldn't have been called Nope. It should have been called Don't Look Up. Because this definitely looks way better as a movie for Don't Look Up than the Netflix film of the same name, which was a trash film overall. But ultimately, when it comes down to it, Jordan Peele's Nope is a solid film with great cinematography, great sound, great performances from all the leads in the film. The third act is very sci-fi heavy. It's a thrill ride at the end. But ultimately, when it comes down to it, I think there's too many loose ends of story elements that really just don't quite fit. There's a subplot with Steven Yeun's character that really... does not matter, and they focus way too much time on, and ultimately, it just doesn't, it felt disjointed, it just doesn't work for me overall as a whole, but I still enjoyed the film overall. In terms of recommendations, if you're a fan of Jordan Peele, you're gonna be checking out this movie anyway. If you're a fan of all these performers, you're gonna check this movie out anyway. So, if you're on the fence on whether or not you'll like this movie or not, if you like sci-fi films with a little dash of horror, I think you will... for the most part, enjoy this film. Now, in terms of me, if I had to choose between an alien film as Nope or M. Night Shyamalan's Signs, I'm going to pick Signs because I think Signs is the better film overall. But that's just me. So go to my overall score. I'm going to give Nope a 72%. I hope you guys enjoyed this review. If you guys did, go ahead and hit that like, share, and subscribe button to the channel so you guys stay up to date with all the latest videos pop up on the Movie Crusaders. Of course, you can follow us on all the social media outlets you see below. Coming up next, I will be having a review for Netflix's The Gray Man at some point this weekend, probably tomorrow night. And then we will also be coming back, Brian Michaels and myself, for the Movie Crusaders chat about Marvel MCU's Phase 4 so far. So that'll be up on the channel at some point this weekend. Last week, we had our actor, actress, director showcase where we talked about Taika Waititi, Carla Gugino, and Brad Pitt, that's right. next week, we should have reviews for DC Super League of Pets, as well as any other movies that come out. And then, of course, August 5th, we got Bullet Train, Hulu's Predator Prey, or it's just called Prey, and Bodies. So we got plenty of videos coming out here, as well as next week's franchise flashback, where Brian and I talk about the Alien Predator franchise before Prey's release on the 5th. So plenty of videos to check out, and until next time, guys, in case I don't see you, good morning, good afternoon, and good night, Movie Crusaders.
You're still here. It's over. Go home.